Hello, and welcome back to Bitwig Studio. Today, let's build a, you could call it a hi-hat programmer. I'm going to say let's build a Stewart Copeland, because you have to give respect where it's due. So the idea, we've been looking at note effects. What I want to do is make an easy way with some interesting controls using note effects to trigger some hi-hat patterns. We had some ideas of this in the previous video, but for me, this is going to be more of a hybrid, production-friendly, performance-friendly type instrument. So I've got a couple different hi-hats here in the factory library, or kits of hi-hats, and that's what I want. I want different sounds, different elements. Okay. Let's just go with that. That feels a little bit like the variety that I want, and it sounds like... Yeah, these seem to be samplers with some different layers of velocity in them. That seems perfect. So let's just start from there. Now, I trust everyone's gotten to a place in the song when it's time to program hi-hats, and you never want to program hi-hats again in your life. So we want notes that are rhythmical. We want notes that happen regularly, and I don't want to have to play them every single time. That sounds like arpeggiator, because that's going to naturally land everything onto the grid. So let's start from eighth notes, maybe. Okay. And already, if I'm holding down different notes, you're seeing that a pattern, it's just going to cycle through them and give me something kind of interesting. Maybe I'll just go ahead and open this view so you can at least see what notes I'm holding down on the keyboard. That's not too bad. Now, there are some different shapes here that might be fun. I think up is okay, but if we're being free, and this is why we're going with hi-hats instead of trying to program bass drums or something like that that tend to have positions in the bar, random might be an okay pattern also. Or at least maybe I might want to go between those two every once in a while. There's a bunch of possibilities here. Flow would be okay too for actually playing the order of the notes that they occur, but we'll just stick with up for now. So the reason these are all in a chain is not just because it's easy to save in a preset, it's because in the end, I might want to have some modulators that are reaching in and playing around with it. So maybe the note rate is something that I'd like to have control at the top level. Now, one thing that's going to make this more interesting is if I can also, on occasion, play the wrong pitch. And as we've seen in different contexts, the randomized device is pretty good. It targets all possible note expressions. And of course, one of those is pitch. So I'm saying just randomize pitch. And maybe let's make it unipolar, only go in one direction instead of going in both. So now... up to three semitones up. If we go to zero, all the same note. A little bit of slush. That's kind of fun. And having that range of pitch would be pretty useful. So we've got a semitone amount here. Cool. There's a little bit there. Can play with pitch, can make something out of that. Now, we have those velocity layers, so velocity is something I do want to play with. Number one, I want to randomize velocity a little bit, and indeed, we've got a velocity curve device. I could have done this on randomize, But to me, velocity curve is pleasantly visual. It just gives something useful and nice to me. So maybe we'll keep that. Name it something a little more useful. Okay. Now, a slightly counterintuitive control, if I want to make velocities change over time, is first, I want them to be the same all the time when notes start. Fair enough. Now, of all these devices, note length is actually going to be pretty handy here, because one of the parameters it has is for deciding, hey, I really want to use a fixed velocity level, and when I use that level, then I can decide what it is. Now remember, we still have the randomize coming after this, but at least it gives us a starting point. And what's really interesting here is it's actually going to let me shift it over time. So even if I'm just holding the same notes down quite a bit, I can automate that and shift the velocities being used over time. That seems pretty handy to me. Now, let's go a little bit deep for a minute. One thing I want to do sometimes, and again, randomization is going to be okay here, I would occasionally like whatever beat time I'm in to shift to double time. Now that's going to work out pretty well because the options here are just one after another, and saying plus one with a modulation would actually push it to the next level. But this is a little bit tricky. I'm going to start with a button device. And there are reasons, but button is our hero today. I want, in this case, instead of just completely slushing around to different values, I want to go to a very particular value. So with button, I'm going to turn it on, I'm going to map it, and it's plus one. Yeah. It seemed to be from 0.5 up. Now that's interesting. Because, oh, it fits, how glorious. Because where we're going to go with this is to say, yes, I do want to generate some kind of random value. It can just be flat up and down. I do want it tempo synced because we want it to happen with notes. Why not? Maybe at the 16th note interval is a good place for it to happen. So we have all these values spitting out, synced, yes, to the time base. But now these are the things I want to say sometimes go up, sometimes go down. How do I set this to be a clean percentage? If I just fully assign this to affect that double time button, it looks vaguely like it's happening about half of the time, and there's a good reason for that. We saw 0.5 a minute ago was the threshold. When we see trigger signals inside the grid or in other environments, it tends to be, oh, 0.5 or up, that's on. Below 0.5, that's off. That's how we handle the Boolean situation. So in this case, I'm sending all these values, I'm getting it to work half of the time, but I really just want a control that tells me, oh, you're set to 50%, oh, you're set to 20% of the time, or 80% of the time. I want something to work in a chance range. So, I'm going to cheat. I've got this button. The very useful thing about modulators is that control signals in the world over tend to sum. They tend to add together. So if this is the signal coming out, and it's about 0 to 1 because it's unipolar, and right now I want to start from a place of 0%, this is never happening, and going to 100%, no matter what happens, it's occurring all the time. So I think I need to make the value going into button lower. I think I need to subtract it a bit. So I've got this macro. It just lets me set a fixed value or a constant. I'm going to set it to bipolar so I can go in both directions. And now, with it fully mapped to the button over there, I'm going to go down, and I'm guessing around negative 50% is where we're going to get to the place that this is incredibly rarely or never coming on. And that looks right to me. So this button is really just my offset. He's my math. So let's leave it down there so that we can have a nice chance knob now. I want a second macro. I want it to be nice and clear. I will call it chance. I will again fully map it to the button. We now have three control signals mapped over here. And if I set this to 50%, I have a feeling that about half the time, or all the time at double speed, or never at double speed, or just occasionally. It is nice to have a very direct control. So, it actually worked out. And again, what's going on? Well, the random value from 0 to 1 is going to the button, which is also getting a negative 0.5, so that that 0 to 1 never really reaches 0.5. It's somewhere between it. And then I can actually set a chance level to push some of those values up. So with uniform distribution, I got a nice chance percentage for when things are going to happen and slush around and occur. You can see I'm holding down different notes. I get a pattern out of it. All right. Now, one more little idea on top of this entire modulation bit, because this is a bit of a modulator review. I want something tempo synced again. I want to think in terms of, over the course of one bar, I have what looks very much like a phase signal, because it kind of is a phase signal. I'm going to go from 0 to 1 so that I can clearly end up in a different place than I began. And what I want to do is to use this chance value to make the end of the bar more likely to have double time notes than the beginning of the bar. Now, a little bit counterintuitively, I'm going to program this down. Now, why am I doing that? So it looks like that 0.16, it looks like I'm basically shifting by 16, or let's say 14% over the course of the bar. Now, to take that and have it end, the only thing is I want it to go the opposite direction, which is not really a problem, because I've got this LFO affecting chance, and instead of it going up, I want it to end at 0. So it's going to go from maximum to 0. And now, over the course of each bar, I'm ramping up to the chance value. Now, why do I want it to do that? Why did I go through all of this exercise of putting in all these funny looking modulators? Well, I want something that is clear and readable. And right now it's telling me at the end of the bar, I can clearly see I'm at 26%. I don't have to do any math in my head to get there. And then as we get there, the chance increases. So let's hit play so we're in the tempo sync for a minute. Maybe a little curve would be nice. So the highest values come a little later. And again, if I wanted that range to be bigger, I could just remap this LFO and say go from something significantly lower. That could even mean, oh, I'm pushing down to 0 for the whole bar. Until the end, I have some chance of things occurring. But I'm okay with this range as is. It feels pretty good to me. So the whole time, I mean, if this is a non-zero chance, there is a chance that we're going to jump into double time at any moment. And that's fine. I want this to be playful and for things to move around. I've got a pitch control for saying we're saying how much should each note push the pitch around. We can see it in the drum machine there. I've got these velocity controls, which are awfully handy for saying where's the general starting point. Start quiet. A lot of randomization. Then push towards the harder. Some randomization, because that can also make it go down a bit. That feels pretty good. And the one hidden thing that we might forget in all this is that because of how the arpeggiator is working, I could throw in some notes that are not triggering drum cells at all. So if I play something drastically below, I'm now saying play fewer notes. Don't play as many notes all the time. Give me some, what are they called? Oh, rests. Give me some rests. So we've got all this working now. Let's just go ahead and make a second track so that we can actually capture the output. And go ahead and print both. And just try something out. So that's something. I only had to lay into a few notes with a few controls. I generated a lot of something. I could cut into a pattern and use it. And if I need to edit it perfectly, I've got that output already to make a song. Thank you for joining us. We'll see you next time.